Soy National. This kind of works like a franchise, so you buy into the name, basically. So we own 5 plants. And there, currently I'm a product designer. I've been working there for 4.5 years now. I actually came out of college with a BFA in graphic design, so I was going to make some bomb posters, do some branding. Then I took one web design class, learned a little bit of HTML and CSS, and just kind of finagled my way into digital design. Started a small internet marketing company, ended up at Cross. When I started there, though, coming from that background, I was actually strictly just a web designer or a visual designer or a UI designer, because nobody could settle on a term for it. So I was very focused on just the visuals of our websites. Then about a year and a half to 2 years into my time at Cross, I got the opportunity to work in an extreme programming format with Chelsea and Arnold, building the Blue Cross Blue Shield mobile app. So screens on the left are the old version that actually, when I first started at Blue Cross, I helped Arnold put together, ironically enough. And then the more updated screens are what we worked on and lifted and is currently in both iOS and Android app stores. So today I'm going to talk about the dynamic duo of designer and dev. I want to give a little background of where I started to where I'm at now to illustrate that now designers are coming from very different backgrounds. Again, I just come from a print background. So there can be some friction and not understanding of what each realm is focused on and what we're doing. And as I was putting together this talk, I was thinking to myself, all right, I could go the route of playing out the old school tropes of, okay, the developer is an analytical thinker, very nerdy, geeky, whatever designers are too. And designers are the creative types, right? But I kind of fell back on my human-centered practice. It's like we're all people, we're all complex and very multifaceted, so it's not fair to typecast everybody or create a persona, as they say in the industry. But I really wanted to focus on how we're not that different. We have different realms that we're working in, but we're all creative, designer, developer. The only difference is the way that we tackle those problems are through different mental frameworks. So developers are going to tackle that problem through code. Designers are going to tackle it through UX research, user interaction design, etc. So first, I just want to give a little background, kind of illustrate what design really is. Term, it's very generic in general. And I'm going to start by saying what design is not. It's not making things pretty. That's a cool side product of it, but that's not the focus. Design is not a career that requires a flannel beard and glasses. As you can see, I have no glasses on. That was my crappy joke for the presentation. Design is about understanding your users, your customers, your members. How do they interact with a product? How do they want to interact with a product? How does what they say actually translate to behavior? Design is about understanding and being empathetic to people at the end of the day. We put your end user at the center of everything we're doing, because you can build a product all day long, but a person has to use it. So for the rest of the talk, I'll focus on digital design. But when I said design's a loaded term, I like this Venn diagram, pointing out all the different specialties and focuses you can have in a design field. And this one is really only showing mainly user experience design. You have industrial design, all sorts of fields out there. But I'll try and talk from a digital perspective. And keep in mind, throughout the talk, designers are your friends, not your enemies. So product design, at least, is kind of a combination of two different facets. So UI, user interface design, the look, and then UX, user experience design, basically the feel of the product. So UI is what most people instinctually jump to when they hear design, right? Because it's the making a pretty aspect of the work that gets the notice. It's not to say that UI is not important, because it is, though. Spacing, type hierarchy, colors, utilization of the negative space so that the content that sits there be readable are all important for how does your end user interact and consume this information? How do they interact with that functionality? The design, the look of it is telling them how to interact with it. It's guiding them. The look can also communicate brand principles, brand in general. So if a person has had prior experience with the company, they're more likely to trust it. Just on the flip side, if I end up at a very crude website and it's asking for my payment information and it looks like it was designed in 1998, I'm not going to trust it. The functionality can be there, but there is an aspect of the UI that instills that trust. They've actually done some studies that show they took two sites, same functionality. One looked more modern, one looked a little bit older, and people expressed having an easier time on the more modern look, even though the features and functionality were all the same. It's a perception that that UI creates that really gets to the core of how people are going to interact with what you're doing. Now, on the flip side, you have user experience design, which is the feel. So UX is focused on making sure that functionality and information is intuitive. We try to establish and utilize common design patterns, drop-down to drop-down, radio buttons to radio button, right? These are simple ones. There's also user research that's involved in it, because we can rely on design patterns to a certain extent. They've been tried and true, but the context for which you're building matters. So here, not the best screenshots of my day, but I have two sites, Airbnb and Zillow. At their core, you're searching for a property, right? But the context is different. If I'm on Airbnb, I'm searching to rent a place for a short amount of time, most likely for a vacation, or if I'm traveling and I need to stay somewhere cheap. Zillow, on the other hand, is focused on, okay, I need to buy. You could rent, but it's a more long-term engagement. So if you look at the UIs and the UX of it, Zillow focuses on this price. What is it a month, right? That's big and bold there, because that's the focus when you're in Zillow. The flip side, Airbnb has stay near Chicago landmark. They've identified why you're on that site, what your actual goal is, and so they've surfaced up new information, new functionality, new content to try and push you and help you in your end goal of finding a place to vacation. Just to give a little insight, as I was talking about user research, we want to validate everything. We can only go off so many assumptions, but once you start talking to users, you actually start to see how far off or, you know, on the right path you were. So these are just a couple of the methods that we utilize. So in-depth interviews, referred to as IDIs, we'll sit down one-on-one with the person, go through a script, dive into high-level concepts, what are their behaviors like, what do they utilize now. Hard source we use for information architecture and navigation. So having the user cluster titles, names, concepts together to see how they mentally model these things. So then when we go to build that navigation, we can start to cluster those links, those pages together in a way that's intuitive and makes sense. Usability testing is getting down and gritty, like, okay, does this button work well in this position? Is it getting cut off on a smaller device? Is that causing an issue and stopping somebody from achieving their end goal in the product? Journey maps, this takes a much higher level approach where we start to look at not only the product itself, but how did they get to that product? Where did they start their journey? Were they in a store? Were they at home? Did they download the app? This builds a better picture for us to get to that context of their situation so we can better design for what they're looking for. User observations is just watching somebody interact with it. People interact with their phone in vastly different ways constantly. I mean, watch somebody give a presentation or fiddle around on their computer. How did they get to a file? How did you get to a file? People model these things differently and tackle them differently. And then co-design is kind of a cool one. You actually bring the user in and you both work to a solution. So you're getting their feedback at the same time engaging them in the creative process, and more likely to open up and come up with some cool solutions. So why does this matter? Get to the point of the talk, the designer and developer duo. So the way that I look at it is, imagine your product is a lockbox. There's gold inside the lockbox. That's your functionality, your features, your value that you're adding, that you're displaying to the member. Design is the key that unlocks that lockbox. So if you have a bunch of gold in that lockbox, but you don't have the right key, nobody's going to get at it, and it's not going to be useful. They can't invest it. They can't take it out, whatever. On the flip side, if you have the key with an empty lockbox, cool, there's no value to it. So it's really, I wanted to harp away at this fact that we need to work together in unison to really lift these products. start, you have to develop close relationships with the designer developer duo. I've worked with developers offshore on separate teams, and then I've been embedded with development teams. And I can tell you the best projects are the ones where we're all on the same page. We are giving back and forth feedback, and we're all working towards one goal and one solution. So tip number one, be proactive. Designers can be a bit of dreamers at times, and if we're not constrained, you don't tell us what we can and can't do, we're gonna come up with some crazy shit. And so getting out ahead of it and trying to get engaged. So not every organization is going to bring your developers in at the design phase, right? It's a fine line. You need to learn how to balance, identifying when's the best opportunity to get there. But take it as your own responsibility as well. If there's not an organizational structure or a team set up to foster that, shoot an email, get on a call, grab a coffee. This is the first step in building that relationship and making sure that you are all synced and working towards the same goal at the end of the day. And by getting out early enough in the design process, we're going to come up with more feasible designs because we have a better understanding of what are the constraints and like how can we solution for that, knowing that we have this box that we can use. We can't use this large chest. I'm really bad at analogies sometimes. But again, I think establishing that relationship at the beginning is also going to lead to better working path down the road. It won't be so much back and forth, handing it over the fence. It is that collaborative approach. Number two, ask questions. Designers can tend to focus on happy paths only. You guys realize, okay, that's cool, but what happens in these eight other scenarios? Data didn't come through, there's a network error. What happens when your list goes from 5 results to 100 results? How does that change? Good designer will try and tackle that as much as possible, but you guys working in the code have a much better understanding of where are those faults, right? And so by asking the questions, how should this design work when this fails? Or, you know, if we do have to load 200 pages of results, right, is this going to change the design? Ask how things should look, feel, and work, too. If you're confused about the functionality, if it wasn't well documented, it's not going to help anybody by just trying to come up with it on your own. You're going to piss off a designer with a very particular vision of their product and how it should act. So just ask the questions. They're more than likely going to answer them. The anecdote I have is we had an iOS developer named Kennedy, very smart guy. Would come to me about every 40 minutes with at least 5 questions. So that was a little overkill at times, but I'm glad he did come to me and talked about it because he would notice inconsistencies. Like, I'm designing multiple screens a day, something slipped, he's been working with the code, he sees, oh, well, this button has 4-point rounding, this one has 2-point rounding, what should it be? That question then puts it back on me to better clarify and identify for the developers, like, this is the standard, this is the consistency we're looking for. So don't be afraid to ask. And also, too, through that Q&A kind of portion of that, like, I've worked with developers and they've asked the question, I didn't know how to answer it, and then they've come up with, well, here's some technical solutions that we might be able to implement as options, right? If you give designers options, it's going to make it easier for us to kind of come down to a decision so that you guys can keep moving forward and building your product. Number three, listen to your users. I think historically, people keep the devs away from the user research, and I think that's a mistake. Anytime we do plan a user study on our mobile app or a member portal at Blue Cross, I make it a point to include the developers. I think having developers sit down in the room, watch a human being interact with a product that you are building is definitely enlightening. I think we use analytics and usage metrics to identify how many people are using our product at the end of the day, but it's dehumanizing to a point. I think by sitting there watching somebody interact, you understand why you're building that product. And not only for the cool, good feeling you get inside, you might notice something, like maybe there's results are taking too long to load, right? You start to see the impacts of issues in the code or issues gap that you can come up with technical solutions for. So I think it's really good at grounding you. And then number four, grab a drink. Coffee is also a drink, not promoting, just going out drinking alcohol. Although it's fun. So it's basically, to sum up, it is all about this relationship building for present and future products. If I start to form relationships with these developers now when we're working here and we start to shift or a new product comes down onto our laps, we've already established this working relationship. You don't have to be best friends, but get onto a talking level with them. Designers are shy, introverted people. Developers can be shy, introverted people. Designers can be extroverted and rambunctious, and so can developers. People at the end of the day make friends with them. And keep in mind too, as you're building these relationships, designers are under the same pressures, deadlines, changes coming up from stakeholders. I think we should all shift the way that we view this. We're all in the trenches together, really. Back to the earlier point, design without development, you don't get a product, and development without design, you don't have a successful product. So really focus on talking to the designer. And then, any questions?
Do you use like A/B testing at all, or any sort of empirical methods to get evidence that informs some of the software side of things?
Yeah, so we've done A/B testing on a couple of sites. Sometimes it's just like based off the like software that we're using, but we want to gather as much empirical data to inform our decisions, right? We know of established patterns. We kind of have an assumption as to where people or what people want out of the product, but again, like. A lot of the reasons product fails is a top-down approach. You have all these business stakeholders saying, this is what we need, without really understanding why they need it, or even if they do understand why, they want to implement designs or functionality that doesn't really suit what that person is using for. So not only when we do user research, we get a bottom-up view of what our people actually want, but then through usability studies and empirical data, we actually have backing to support it. So we can kind of fight back against requests. Any other questions?
How heavily should an engineering team rely on the style guide?
How heavily? Good question. I'm trying to put one together right now. It should be your first go-to. The designer should have that shored up. If you start to see inconsistencies in the design compared to a style guide, definitely bring it up and ask questions. It really comes down to the designer in that sense. If they're on top of their game and keeping that updated, that's pretty good to go to. And hopefully it's robust enough too. I think sometimes we fall into traps where we'll put together a style guide, it's got some colors, some type hierarchy, you know, here's a form. We don't really explain or illustrate, okay, what are the use cases for it? How does it react when you click into it? What's a focus state compared to a hover state? So that is lacking at times. I think a style guide is a good reference, making sure that you're on track, it's consistent, but try and get out and ask the developer or the designer if you really see a huge inconsistency or have a big question about it.
Cool. Thank you.